that rainy night in Georgia. We all seem to have them sooner or later, don't we, man? Hop on that old boxcar and reminisce and see where we're going to go with all of this, eh? Oh, my goodness, when you're down, you're coming around. Remember that today, okay? Because you just found Spring Creek, the veritable headwaters of life, here on the Hazy Radio Network with your old friend and compadre, Grandpa Pietro Coyote, better known as the Grandfather of Love. Yes, indeed. Well, on occasion, once in a while, known as an ornery old shit, too. Do a little of all that, but we're loving no matter what we're up to, man. Even if we're chastising and rebuking ourselves. Nah, baby, we learned a long time ago. Well, not that long ago, but anyway, we learned not to do that anymore. But, you know, you chastise and rebuke yourself. Well, you're rebuking everybody, and oh, my goodness. Next thing you know, we're all rebuked and puked out, and, you know, it's just a big puddle of vomit everywhere, and it's just sickening, man, and we don't want to be there, do we? No, babies, but really, to show that we care, keep that good energy flowing over there to those folks that are having their rainy night in California right now, up there in the northern end of the Sacramento Valley. They're near the Feather River. Oroville Dam is going down. And let's keep the energy going there. Let's see if we can keep it from failing. See if we can get it coming around. I don't know how we can avoid it because, man, it's pretty corroded already. And it looks like there's going to be another week of really nasty weather. And babies, I tell you, I know a lot of you know that country, a lot of you don't, you know, but that Feather River and them big old Sierra Nevadas, they can be treacherous, as we all well know. We must, you know, and I've never seen it rain as hard as it can up there. And babies, when you get conditions like this, the Chinook conditions, well, we've seen some terrible, horrible floods before, but I ain't never seen nothing like this. Doesn't surprise me, though, like we've talked before, the engineering and construction on those dams wasn't always what it was meant to be, and therefore, you know, because people think they can get away with it. They think, well, if we cut back and do this instead of that, you know, then it's still going to hold and nobody will know the difference, you know, blah, 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 you know what I mean? So they take chances and risks with millions of people's lives, just for the sake of expediency, a few extra dollars slipped to them under the table, whatever. It's totally insane. But we see this across the board in our reality, from the top to the bottom and as wide as it can be. That, you know, just about everybody, thank goodness not you and me, but just about everybody around us is on the take in some way. Everybody's getting bought off or stupefied down or not even thinking about coming around, you know, just give me, I want what I want and I'm going to take it all, you know, etc. You know, it's just some crazy attitudes. But look at how people are changing. The bulk of us, not so inclined anymore. I mean, you know, we're learning. We don't know. You know, the bulk just haven't quite figured it out yet, so the world is one crazy little place right now, you know. But I really, you know, California, it's the perfect place to bring people back together because it's where they've been fractured apart about as bad as it can be. You know, people live in fear there a lot, you know. And like I said, the neighborhoods there in these small towns and big cities, it don't matter. They've been divided for quite a while now. Each person for themselves and the gangsters taking over and the cartels moving in and violence and murder everywhere and speed up the gazoozy. I mean, shit. And robberies and violence and the devil may care, you know, you got to be afraid. Well, people are learning, you don't got to be afraid, and we're all in this same boat together. And this shit, this terrible illness we've had, where we felt so fractured and alone and so paranoid as to kill others to protect ourselves. Jesus. Guys, where in the hell do such ideas come from? That's about it makes as much sense as, well, we can cut this corner here and that kind of corner there and do it under the contract. Nobody will know, you know. Here, take a few bucks and let's get away with it, okay? You know, it doesn't work that way, babies. Or, you know, the engineers, man, that's tough. I know it shows that it's going to wash out and blow out the whole damn thing if there's ever, but you know, that spillway's there. It's so high. And, oh, what the hell? Let's design it that way. You know, people just don't always go with the flow. And sometimes they're paid, you know, quite often, just to shut up and go with the other flow, which is, you know, the flow of money, you know, the high profitability of cutting corners and doing things, you know, under the QT, as they call it, or on the take, you know, and shit, babies. Your janitor, you know, at the office building where you work has been paid to snoop in your garbage, baby. I mean, you know, that's how bad it's gotten, you know. The garbage man gets paid to snoop in your garbage. And the postman gets paid to drop a little mic in your mailbox, man, when he delivers your mail, or she does, as the case may be, etc. I mean, there is so much corruption in this reality. The kid down at the gas station, I mean, now what kind of corruption could they possibly be involved in? Well, maybe some of their friends paid them off to shut up and have a lot of money in the cash register when they come to rob them. I mean, such stuff is not unheard of in this reality. In fact, it's quite common. You know, I mean, our society has deteriorated and degenerated so severely that integrity has gone out the window, and there ain't any, or damn little. I'm happy for the people that do try to treat each other right. And, you know, like my parents, they were really, really, really messed up people, you know, some religionists that were really... had some odd ideas about life, but I tell you what, they set a good example for me, because they believed in taking care of their own first and foremost, but never refusing a stranger either, you know. We had a lot of unusual people come and go in our lives when I was a young kid growing up in that crazy environment. You just wouldn't believe. Parents were so corrupted, but so loving and caring for the people around him, that mama wouldn't even turn a hobo away, you know. She'd make him go pull some weeds or something before she'd feed him, but she'd feed him better than she fed us kids, you know. They took care, and, you know, there was always cousins and people like that coming around that needed a little help out, needed a place to stay for a while, etc. And maybe, you know, the door was always open. They always took care of their own. I was just, you know, so blessed to have that kind of an example before me, even though I couldn't possibly buy all the nonsense that went with it, you know, the religious side of things, but maybe the political side of things, where they, you know, as I call it, where they really showed that they cared and took care of people and were real community-oriented, and when there was disasters in our community, baby, people pulled together and took care of one another. There was no question about it. You know, that, I mean, there was a lot of awfulness in that culture, but there was a lot of good, too, because of things like that. It was a lot more than neighborly, you know. It was the exact opposite of what California was. Even back then, people in California were not very friendly with one another. Maybe with the people they worked, etc. You had your own little crowd, your own little niche. The neat thing about it was, there's so damn many people there that whatever niche you were into, there's going to be a bunch of people that want to niche with you. So it was good in its own way. So in its own way, despite its fractured nature, you know, and the reservations that people, you know, held in themselves, and the bitterness they looked down their noses at the rest of humanity with, either as a victim or as a celebrant that felt better than everybody else. I live in Beverly Hills, man, you know, and I got my own, you know, entertainment attorneys and shit. Like, I'm, you know, I'm better than you are by a long shot, you know. That kind of thing went on a lot too, you know. And of course, you know, then there's those that are so paranoid, they surround themselves with bodyguards and gunmen and cameras and lights, and hell, they live in a frickin' prison, man. They're so paranoid. I mean, you know, it goes that far sometimes. And it's not just the folks in Beverly Hills. You see that out in Urbania, too, every now and then. Oh, God, it's been crazy, man. But of course, it's time for this to all change, you know. And this is why this society has gotten so far out of hand. And again, why we've got such a fractured sumbitch back there in Washington trying to run things, man, you know, etc. And the wrong parties and the wrong people in all of those positions. Well, mostly. There's a few good folks, of course. But mostly, whoo, bunch of damn criminals and worse than that. Just no integrity. Bunch of sleazeballs, man, you know, no integrity. A lie is better than the truth any day of the week. And how, what do you want me to say today? Just please tell me, Master. Master, please let me be your baiter, okay? It's almost that bad, if not worse. And this is why we're coming to conclusionary stages in this reality. Now, a lot of people, you know, expect disasters and big ones like what's happening in California right now, you know, and Fukushima, which, you know, by rights we all should be dead. You got to wreck or the oil well in the Gulf of Mexico. That dumb motherfuckers are down there drilling some more. God! These people are so retarded, we got to love them out of it. I'm talking about the oil company, the oil industry in general, the redneck attitude that goes with it, the insanity of raping your Mother Earth in such obscene ways. It's about as sick as humanity has ever gotten. And we think we're just exploiting her mineral wealth. That is total bullshit. We are raping our mother and hurting her and harming her right to the heart. But you know, because she is our mother and because she understands the control freaks behind this kind of behavior, that you too are being manipulated and controlled by other energies that are manipulated and controlled by other energies. But eventually it leads to a place where there is no manipulation and control. It's all one life together, don't you know? The illusion is the separation and then the need for manipulation and control, because you are separate and you need to be powerful and these other slime dogs don't. Oh, baby, see? So, let's just keep our eye on what's really happening here. We've got a gracious heart inside of each person that lives, and it's beginning to refine itself into being. Now, I think it's a little sick and tired of watching her children go astray. So I think she's like creating a few different kinds of disasters these days. And each one leads us a little more close to where we need to be. For example, now, in my personal life, you know, not these aren't necessarily all, you know, tragic circumstances that are happening worldwide. You know, it's personal shit, too. To redirect you, to get you going in the right flow, to help you refine your understanding of yourself, don't you know? Or maybe you get you out of it before it gets to be too much for you, whatever that case may be. Because maybe you're better off on the other side. Let nature take you where she will. Most of us ain't going that way. I know a lot of folks think there's going to be massive death and a big separation in society, because there is already a huge separation. That's what's there now. That's what we're talking about. This be a bright and beautiful day here at the headwaters of life, Spring Creek. You betcha, man. You and a whole bunch of angels, too, joining in, because we are the angelic realm as human persons. Which means we're powerful, baby, beyond belief. We can stop a disaster like that. And I'm telling you, that dam is going to blow the earth inside of it. It's going to go. It's going already. It's washing out bad. And like I say, the pressure of the new water coming behind, because it's going to start raining again tonight, and it's got that Chinook condition where the warm south winds are blowing up and melting all that deep snow. I mean, they've had 10, 20 feet up there in those mountains already, you know? I mean, and that's a lot of water. And it's really wet snow up there. It's not like the dry shit we get over here in the Rockies. Time we get the snow over here, it's been wrung out by several ranges of mountains, you know, having to go up and over that. So we just get the leftovers here in Colorado. Then it regenerates when it passes over these mountains here. Once it goes over the Front Range, it starts to mix with that Gulf air. And again, then you got all the crazy weather on east of us, you know. But there we are, babies, in our heart. Dreaming this a little differently. Maybe if this dam has to rupture, we can keep it to a slow rupture instead of a boom all at once that would, you know, create such massive destruction. Maybe if we keep our heart in there strong enough, we can keep this thing from going altogether. And maybe when the weather's over with and it's held up, even though it's washed out here and there and lots of bad things have happened, that it's held up basically. If we can keep it in that condition, maybe then they can, you know, after all the weather's gone, they can get this thing repaired and nobody has to, you know, no huge property loss or life, loss of life, either one. Maybe we can do that. Whatever it is, you know, it's all in a degree that the people there need this disaster and how much they're calling of it to themselves in order to bring themselves back together, back to life. See, because we're in these stages in this world now, all around this world, not just here, but everywhere. Turtle Island's just the beginning. But everywhere, we're in this stage where people are waking up. And they're doing things like this in an intrinsic, creative sort of way. Kind of background energy at work. That's what it seems to be in the 3D anyway. The reality is we're creating it, yes. To bring ourselves back together. And to help those along the way that don't want to be here and don't want to participate in that way. But really, we're all in this together. Our heart is a singular presence of consciousness. Each one of us is a singular presence of consciousness, but that singular presence exists in all of us. So the individual is the individual of creation, the mother love, as I call it. You take it as you will. That's how I feel it. And that's what creates inside it. Of course, it's active with what you would call a male energy too, but I see them as a unified energy, not a polarized one, not a male and a female, but more or less an androgynous. It knows its male and female sides and celebrates them. Yes, and it knows how to celebrate them too. It's way beyond the sleazy shit we've been doing here. Way beyond it, man. You know, it's time for us to get it clear. Now, there's fun with that little teenagerish shit, yes, but when it gets a little older and all corrupted and all crazy, undo it. Let it be done. Just like we're undoing this economic reality, peace here and a peace there, but it's going and it's going fast. And just like we're showing ourselves the resolve of the human heart, we have no idea how strong our heart is until we're facing things like Fukushima and oil wells threatening to kill off all of our oceans, etc. You know what I mean? And something happens where we find containment, we find neutralizing radiation. We find we can not only endure a lot of that radiation, baby, it makes us stronger. It's healing us instead of killing us. And you see, and it's the same with the poisons they're putting in the atmosphere with their jet airplanes, trying to quote control the weather. That's not weather control, that's controlling whether or not you're going to live to tell about it. And mostly they don't want us around, the elitist I'm talking about, those that work in the background, that have pushed our government into the ground, along with the whole society worldwide. But America, you're a disgusting piece of shit. Well, your land and your heart will always be remembered. But what you've done and what you've become, sleazy and disgusting. But we love you for it, man. We love you for your sleaze. For hiding, you know, behind the mafia. You know, we know who's really in control here. It is more than mafia, but we understand the ancient nature of your vileness. And how you've wanted to spread that into the people, and have, you know. And how the people, you know, innocently accept that as their state of being. See, we're not dealing with people so much. People are occupied here. We're dealing with powers, energies, that which operates in the background. It seems, now understand, this is the heart level. It's multidimensional. And we are the ones creating even this ugly experience. You know, all this piece of shit in this reality, so that once we get through it, we boil it down to the basic elements that manage to stay loving despite some really incredibly trying conditions. And we've come out of it not only alive, but wildly so. We've come back into the heart of our real human nature. And we're going to be there and going to live there forever. See, like I was telling you, my personal life, and this skin cancer thing, which normally, I got to tell you, I would be able to cure before it became anything too serious. Normally, that would have been my circumstance. But it wasn't to be so this time. I needed to go back to that edge of death, I guess, in this physical reality. All I knew was I was facing something. I was about as anti-doctor as you get. I don't like doctors. I don't like going to doctors, you know? But in this case, I could see that that was the remedy that was just, I was being compelled into. There wasn't anything else. I tried a lot of other things. Wasn't anything else working. There was much there that helped, but nothing that would stop it. It kept on growing and, you know, nearly killed me, like I told you before. By the time I finally checked into the hospital to get myself operated on, I was, you know, close, babies. It was just, you know, a step or two away from going into my brain and killing me, this cancer was. That's how far I let it go before I finally submitted to the 3D world of surgery, you know. And I was scared to death, man. I really was. Even though I have complete faith in this reality, I was just knocked for a loop. Just like I was when I was a little kid and some pretty tormenting shit came my way. And when this stuff happens like that, it's so much bigger than you are, it just throws you out of your person for a while. But little by little, you come back. And I'm sure, you know, I had a part of me that I couldn't get past. It was really hard. That came to me as a child in those moments that were really trying. So I went back through this cancer and this process. And I'm sure the cancer was created by that hard little side of myself that just couldn't change, that just wouldn't roll with it, even though the rest of me was already there. There was this one part just would not go. You know, I've done miracle after miracle in many ways, in many levels here, but I've also had my ass slammed into the ground more than once, and this was again, right there, slamming my ass in the ground hard. And I just can't explain how I felt going into that surgery. You know, and having to breathe in that stuff and knowing I may not come out of this alive, you know, and that I've really been foolish to let it go as far as I did, etc. And not really knowing what they were going to do to me in the first place, just going with it because I didn't seem to have any other choice in the matter. It just seemed to be that was the way it was going to be. You know, that it just kept leading me that way. Nothing of the mystical reality was working on this skin cancer. Yet, it was working me into this place where I really, really had to let go of it all and just put my fate in the hands of the universe. You know, and I trusted the universe, but I didn't know what its intentions were. I couldn't feel them then. I was so far gone from myself. This stuff drains you, man. You know, and I told you, I felt like it came to me as a personal attack from certain energies in this reality. They don't like what I am, don't like my presence, and wants it out of here. Yet, they know better. Because if they get me on the other side, then shh, the gig is up. You know, they just turn me loose. Then I can be everywhere and really influence. Here, I'm kind of restricted in the human dimension to a certain extent. On the other side, I have no restriction. So they really don't want me over there. But they do love to torment me, man, and do love to bring me to the edge of it, and they did it again. But they is me, and me is us, and we were doing it together, even though it didn't seem to be. It seemed like it was running contrary to me, contrary to what my life should be, etc., you know. But this took me right to that place again where I was, you know, knocked almost completely out of my body and had to regain my person, a speck here, a speck there. And regain my person in a physical sense too, because my body was tarnished and trashed when I came out of that surgery. I mean, they did a great job and I bless them for it. And I bless those nurses that took such, they recognized something about me just like I did about them. And they took awesomely good care of me, you know what I mean? I was just really blessed, you know. Don't be afraid if you are being pushed in a direction like this by your own physical presence. And what's going on there. You may be going to a resolving place like I was, and you might have to go to this extreme to get there. Maybe you won't have it near as bad as I did, and you won't have to be hours and hours in surgery. Maybe you can get this over with pretty quickly. And let me tell you, even after all of that, I had to resist some really strong pressure that wanted to go back in and redo this, even though they'd gotten all the cancer and everything. There was one little part of the skin graft they'd given me that wasn't quite taken. And they wanted to do it, you know, and just read. And I had to say no. At first I tried to tell them, look, my body can't take that right now. I'm going to, you know, croak if you do that. And they didn't hear me. They couldn't hear that. They couldn't see that. So, you know, I had to get myself out of that hospital, talk them into waiting a little while, get myself out of that hospital and back home here to Crestonia, which is 4 hours down the road from where I was there in Denver, Colorado, you know. And then, once I got here, make a stand not to go back there and take this surgery, even though I might at some point need it. I just wanted to wait 2 or 3 months. I wanted this stuff to prove out and my body to heal up enough I could take another operation, because I couldn't right then, and I knew it. And I knew they wouldn't hear me, so I just told them I couldn't get a ride. I didn't have a ride, that's what I said. I didn't have a ride, because I hadn't arranged for it. You know, but I just did not want to go back. And turns out, you know, then that doctor dropped me. You know, talk about pressure. I mean, you wouldn't believe. They brought a lot of pressure on me just to submit and go do it their way, you know. But in this case, I knew I couldn't. I mean, in the first case, I knew I had to. But in the second case, I knew I couldn't. not then, and that I wouldn't if I could avoid it. You know what I mean? And turns out that, you know, the good friend here in this Crestonia area that is by coincidence a doctor and a plastic surgeon just happened to be available to take up the slack that doctor, as he dropped me, you know, and told me he wasn't going to be my doctor anymore, then she was able to help me out here. And we did it in a way that was far simpler, you know, and she just took the bad material out and showed me a certain treatment that would get it to grow back in, and it worked. And I'm healed and healthy now in that little area where I would have been tarnished, and it would have taken me another, if I'd have lived to tell about it, another 6 months to a year to get back on my feet, because I would have been knocked that far off of them. And I just wasn't ready to be that. Besides that, I had nobody to take care of me. You know, I had some help here at the time, but I knew it wouldn't last. It was only going to be here for a couple, 3 weeks. You know, I knew that, and I didn't know who else would even want to come and help me or how I'd get that. I did manage for a county nurse, and she was awesome, etc. You know, I did manage to take good care of myself, and I made sure I was taken care of. I went after what I thought I needed, and I had some really good help from the doctor down here in Moffitt and her staff. Some of the best people I ever met in my life. And don't be afraid. If you have to go do a medical thing and you live in the Crestonia area, don't be afraid to go down there and see the guys at the Moffitt Clinic there. It's called Valleywide, or Valleywide Family Clinic or something like that. But they'll take really good care of you if you just give them the chance to, okay? I mean, don't go down there all belligerent with a chip on your shoulder. Go there willing to see what they have to offer and how they will help you. And don't be afraid to ask, you know. This one nurse went way out of her way. Kathy, I love you so much. She went way out of her way to help me get this county nurse coming to my home. So I at least had one professional watching over me while I still had tubes and drains and shit hanging out of me. And I was a mess, man, you know. And I wasn't, like I said, getting that much help, but oh, man, it all worked out. Don't be afraid to go there. And it worked out not only, I mean, I am coming back together inside of myself. So much more present. That one stubborn part of myself, you know, it's transforming. It didn't have to die. And because we went to that edge again, now I wasn't out of my body this time. At least I don't have any memory of that. I know I was close. But I was just knocked out of my body. I was still present here. I still had my anchor, my root, and my humanity, and my 3D, you know. And as I'm now, as I'm pulling my spirit self back into myself and healing body and soul, and that's what you do when you're in states like that, and you just sit there, lie there, and you just reunionate with yourself as much as you can, and you just keep it going, and you keep it going. You don't ever give up. You just keep that energy. And, you know, you get encouragement from all around you. There will be many, many positive things happen. And, you know, there'll be negative things, too. And there'll be negative people trying to pull you off your base. And they might just do it, slow you down a wee bit. But I'm telling you, it just shows you what you don't want to be anymore. So it's like, you know, all in all, it really helps bring you back in a more full and clear presence than you ever had before. If you live to tell about it. And bless it if you don't. Because it's time to go home then. You know, maybe you're being called home. I mean, just whatever fate has in store for you, take a look at it and bless it. And don't get in the way of it. And don't try to force it either. Either one, man. I know you can get so miserable that you just want to frickin' die and get out of here. You know, humans can be, I mean, this condition can be so damn suffering and so damn hard to take. I understand, you know, the desire to die in such moments. But I'm telling you, if you're willing to go just a little bit further with it, you might find your way back to life. And a life, even if you only live it for another 6 months or a year, which I think would be a lot longer, but even if that's all the time you could buy, those 6 months or a year are going to be some of the most dynamic times you've ever known. And you're going to go through great changes because of that. I mean, very, very positive ones. And when you finally do expire, you know, if that's your choice, or that's your direction, you won't be like expiration at all, because you'll still be here. You'll be that conscious, that present. You know what I mean? Death is going away. Life is coming around. And this is the way you got to see it. That whatever's going on for you, severe as it might be, or not so severe, as the case may be, But, you know, I see friends out there and lots of them going through some really weird sicknesses and being really challenged. Just like I was, you know, and most of them, you know, they believe in the mystical and the herbal side of things. They don't believe in the Western medicine. You know, they've seen heinous tortures and shit there. But, you know, there's a time and a place for everything. And if that's where you're being called, baby, don't be afraid. The angels will reach out and take care of you and show exactly what to do, just like they did me when I knew I had to resist that second operation. But embrace the first one. I didn't want to, baby. I didn't want to. But it's, you know, it came right down. You want to live? You better go do that. That's what it came down to. Now, nobody told me that. I just knew that. And it was obvious by the condition this thing got into before I went. And I mean, it went pretty well. Before. I mean, and I never let nobody know. I was able to maintain on the radio, etc. I just kind of kept it to myself. Because I really did think I could deal with it, even when it was getting bad like that. I thought something would come along. Well, the something was surgery, babies, and so that's what I did. And, you know, like I say, if you're in a similar situation or you're living down there in California and threatened by all this, well, bless the whole situation. Do what you got to do, man. Get your ass up the mountain. Don't get flooded on, you know, and take what's important to you, but don't dilly-dally around. Get out of there. But keep the good energy going to that dam. Maybe we can, you know, create some miracles here. Maybe we don't have to check out so severely. Maybe we don't have to go through it as bad as we could. But let's leave it in the hands of the good heart of the universe, because whatever we need is what we're getting. And whatever moments we need to endure is moments that we've created for ourselves to not only endure, but to refine ourselves and to be in the finest that we can be. The richest, most powerful little angels there ever was. And I ain't talking about money, because money is going out the window. It's a shithole. And it's what created most of this misery and suffering in the first place. The greed, the need for money, you see, and for too much of it, and to not do anything to get it, etc. The whole idea that you gotta take, take, take. Whatever the way it is, it boils down to a simple theft and thieving from your fellow persons. You know, I mean, and everybody's done it in their own way. Believe it or not, we all have, you know, because that's the nature of money. Of course, some people do it consciously, and they're the worst ones in this presence, and they're the ones we're here to help transform by showing them the power of the collective heart, and that they're not isolated or alone, and neither are you. You've got a lot of help in what you're facing right now, and here's to you and all that help coming through you. Pay attention. You're not dead. You're coming back to life. No matter which way it goes. That is the fate of the universe holds for Mother Earth and all of her children in this day and age, baby. Just the way it is. I'm glad I'm here with you, man. We got something to celebrate now, don't we? No matter how bad it's been, baby, guess what? It ain't going to bend again now, is it? Ain't no way, man. We've grown them fuzzy little wings back, man. We'd be flying before we even know what happened. Already, we're so doggone high. We already know how to fly, and it don't take wings, does it? Mm-mm. The wings is just a symbolic thing. We like to show off. You know, we are the bird tribe, after all. The whole of humanity. Not just a few. Angels in everyone. Oh, my God. Can you believe it? I don't know, man. There's some folks I really wonder about. Oh, getting it clear, dear. Here on a Monday morning with your old trickster, Grandpa Coyote, yes, indeed, the cosmic clown, hanging around naked again, man. Naked is the day he was born, and every bit is innocent, too. How about you, baby? Can you bury your soul here on the Hazy Radio? Can you let yourself be influenced by the real life, and not by the old unpleasant bullshit that says you gotta, you know, maintain control, etc.? Oh, darlings, don't you know? That's not the way to go. Never was, never will be again. Because that just leads to disaster. Which, of course, pulls people together. And that heals the need for disaster. Ultimately. Okay? So let's keep that disaster from coming our way. Well, then go through what we have to, but baby, bless it all. And see it for the gift that it is, okay? Sometimes losing everything is the best thing that can happen for you, because that shit was just holding you back, man. Time to move on, John. Time to get beyond the pain, Jane, and not need that doggone tranquilizer ever again, or the painkiller, or whatever it else has been that you've been doing to get yourself through. Come back to the heart, and you won't need that shit. You will not be addicted. The addiction is the illusion, baby. The love re-empowers you. Allow it. Then you'll end how it, okay? Ooh, old Grandpa, really, really, really helping us get it underway. Here on this, what is this, Tripping Monday, man? A real trip, I'd say. Well, it's kind of snowy, too, so that gets me feeling real primal, you know what I mean? Ooh, and the jolly joy comes up somehow. I don't know why I'm so happy about snow and cold. Ooh, well, it's beautiful, that's why. So are you, babies, and all of us. In our own right, baby. All of us.